And we're live. Welcome to the show. I'm Kieran Brennan. So the wheels are starting to turn now on the show. We're starting to get some really good guests coming in, and we're learning about. So we started off with learning where to start with the business idea. Where should I start? And then really we started to move into sort of what should I expect when I'm starting as this journey begins. Then we had Wendy Slattery, who my guest might know today from the Beauty Buddy Inn, talking about product and market fit in particular and how to go about achieving product and market fit. And really, all of this is just first and foremost, it's available to go back and listen to on all the podcasts, so please do. But today's guest in particular, when we talk about product market fit, starting a business, starting an idea, would be immersed in this scene. If your business is in Ireland, first and foremost, there's a very strong possibility that you would have come across today's guest. He has a career that spans from sales and marketing executive into product manager for Apple, CEO of a social media agency, TEDx speaker. Then it's sort of training and mentoring, and now he is a rector of the Entrepreneurs Academy. It's some resume. Noel Davidson, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Kieran. It reminds me of I'm going to be 50 at the end of this year, and it's just gone by in a flash. But yeah, everything you said there is true.
It's a smashing resume, but you actually started very close to my world in landscape construction and design. How'd you end up going from there to sales and marketing? Where did that all start?
So born and bred in North County Dublin, and your rite of passage always was either agricultural college or horticultural college. So
Right.
straight after school, leaving cert, I did 1 year in Kinsale Institute. It was an ANCO course, for those of you that are old enough to remember.
Heard about it.
ANCO pre-FOS, pre-SULAS, PETB. But I got to see even back then, the benefit of learning, of courses outside of university, and the value of practical work. So at the time, you think it is of no value when you're out in the fields picking potatoes, snaking turnips, and cutting cabbage. But it was that hands-on that really has, I think, formed my ethos today. So after Kinsale, I did 3 years in the Botanic Gardens and graduated with a diploma in horticulture, and then found myself on a golf course in Dundrum House Hotel, County Tipperary, as site engineer. And they teach you everything in college, practical wise, but not money and practical wise. So I know life costs is something that whenever we met, it was always something. I think back to those golf course days. I wish I had that on the site. The role actually was a good one that it certainly gave me an aspect of planning. You can plan for everything except the weather. So it was very hard to make a lot of money to get yourself through a short summer into a long winter. So I learned that at an early stage.
And then, so you went from there to sort of into sales and marketing, and then you went into Apple as well. How did all that come about?
So how that came about, segueing there from the challenges of the weather, I found that I had to supplement my income, and I had a friend and a colleague that I had worked with, and we formed our first company together, which was called LeisureScope. He was a phenomenal man, and he passed away just over the last year, Philip O'Neill, and he was like a second father to me. And he was a businessman, and when I needed help, I knocked on his door, and he became a mentor and a father figure and a very, very dear friend. And as a result, I ended up working with him. So he had a business that were dealing with Quinsworth, and for those who remember Quinsworth, this was pre-Tesco days. Tesco bought Quinsworth out, and I became marketing distribution manager. We were servicing the 83 stores throughout the country. So then I learned about logistics and the importance of delivering marketing. Now we do it instantly on the internet now, but back in the old days, if Margaret Heffernan or Ben Dunn dropped the price of marmalade from 18 pence to 17 pence, there was a big rush to counter that, print another offer and deliver it. So I learned that, and then from then, I was there for a while, and then Tesco came in and bought them out, and we were gone. And then I went into the marine industry. I have a background, a love of sailing and a love of the water. And they say never work at your hobby, but I gave it a go. And 6.5 years later, I was a yacht broker from 2002 to mid 2008, just if you know, as the crash was about to happen, you could kind of see it happen. So that's where the sales background came. And
that was your first introduction to like face-to-face selling?
Very much, yeah. A different type of selling. So this was a high-value, low-volume product. So a sale could take 7 or 8 months.
Right.
And you built relationships with your clients. If you didn't, you didn't get the sale. And the repeat sale, which was really important.
How important would trust be in that house?
Immense.
Yeah.
You were selling dreams to families,
yeah.
To individuals, and you were making a promise. So sales for me is a transfer of certainty,
yeah.
Where you actually will, if you ask somebody what makes them feel certain, they'll feel calm, comfort, secure. When you're investing a lot of money in a very high value product, you need to feel those things.
Yeah.
So trust was huge.
It's actually similar in a way to my first experience with sales. I came from a construction background, and then I opened up this outdoor living business in Perth, Australia, and we went into this outdoor living space which Australian families spend all their time in. So we went straight into the emotional side, which for me, it meant a lot to me as the seller to make sure that I deliver, because this family would tell me we designed the area, we'd construct the area, and we'd go and install the whole lot, and it meant so much to me to say that these guys are going to sit here and use this area the other day. And I'd imagine what you're saying here is that would have been very much the same. These guys had dreams of getting out on the water, and you were tapping into that sort of emotional side of what they were going to do with their spare time.
Absolutely, 100%, because sales is an emotional transaction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to feel good about it. You can give people all the facts and figures, and they may just turn around and say, that just doesn't feel right. So I didn't realize at the time what I was tapping into, but it was emotional and it was trust. So at the end of 2007, 2008, things were changing and the crash was about to happen. And I know you have your own experience of that, but I got an opportunity when I left the marine industry, and that was by choice. I was lucky enough to see the change coming. And an opportunity came by a gentleman named Tony Boyle, who was a founder and director of Sigma Telecom. And they owned the 3G mobile store network within Ireland. They were for that P2P. Some of you might remember those,
yeah.
P2P stores, and became 3G mobile. And they had people looking after Aircom, after Meteor, but nobody looking after Apple. So I went in as Apple product manager, and I got a chance to work with Apple directly. And that was phenomenal to see the way a large company like that looks after the sales route. But on top of that, I became a trainer. So I qualified as an Apple certified trainer. And part of my role was teaching people in the retail stores how to sell Apple products.
And did Apple have a training for you as a trainer?
Yes, they did.
Was it down to brand values? How did they want you to have their products sold out there?
It was extraordinary. And it was one of the things I really have taken with me, and I thank Apple for the training. It was not what I was expected. So you can tell somebody something and they'll only remember a certain part of it. You could show somebody something and they'll only remember a little bit more. But if you involve them or evolve them in the lesson, the transaction, or whatever it may be,
yeah.
It lands a little bit more. So we used to train the retail experts on the floor of the Apple store or the Apple retail seller how to sell the product. They never touched the product. They always let the customer touch the product. They would observe whether you were right-handed or left-handed. So if you were right-handed, they stood on your left side, so there wasn't a barrier when you have your right hand out touching the mouse.
Okay.
You're not creaking your neck. Little subtle differences. And they were there to help guide and, can I say, coach. Because for the first time I realized there was a difference between a trainer and a coach. And a trainer will ask a question and give the answer. A coach will ask the question and let the participant find the answer, and has much more impact and value. So I really treasured my Apple days.
You done a smashing TED talk a few years back. What year was that?
That was 2012. 2012, 2013, if I remember. November 2012, I think.
Yeah, you're touching something. There's actually a link to Apple here. You're touching
something in that
talk by a guy called Simon Sinek, and the Golden Circle, and he talks about Apple in there. Can you, that whole golden circle mentality, can you talk about that and why that was important for you? What was your thought pattern in getting that into that TED Talk, which would have been a big thing, I'm sure, at the time for you?
Yeah, it was a huge part. So the journey to that was, I was 2 years with Sigma Telecom, and we were having a phenomenal year in 2009, just towards the end of it. And I just turned 40 and went to the States on holidays and came home. And literally the minute that the wheels of the aircraft touched down in Dublin, Sigma Telecom collapsed.
And you booked the holiday, I'm sure, on the back of...
Yeah, and nothing to pay for it, absolutely. Right. The Christmas bonus never came.
Right.
And then I went and did a Start Your Own Business course in Fingal Enterprise Board, as it was at the time. Now they're the local enterprise offices. And that's where I met the owner and founder of the Entrepreneurs Academy, which previously was known as QED Training, they were at the time. And I suddenly said, this is something I could do. And I started to go back into my history and take little snippets of things that I'd learned along the way and then bring them into my training.
Your brand story.
My brand story. Mm-hmm. But there was something missing. I was getting imposter syndrome. You know, where I'm standing in front of people who want to set up their own business or people who had set up their business. And I was feeling that I had just started out, and who was I to train, coach and teach? And then I came across Simon Sinek's video. And it's called Starting With Why, How Great Leaders Inspire Action. I think I've nearly become synonymous with it, because every occasion I can get to show it during a training session, I show it. Yeah. Because it still holds true today. And the message was, people don't buy what you do or how you do it, they buy why you do it. And suddenly everything started to make sense. Everything that I had done in the past, I was doing it for the why,
yeah.
The love, the passion. I was selling boats because I love sailing. So that came across in my enthusiasm when I was speaking to a client or customer. And I genuinely wouldn't put them into a boat if I thought that they weren't going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
I would lose a sale, most to the detriment of my boss at the time, but I had my values,
yeah.
and I stuck to it. I never realized what that was until I saw that video. And then suddenly things made sense. So I was incorporating it into my training, and I happened to be in the main conference center in Dublin. It had only just been built, and I was delivering a session there to an international audience. And a lady came up to me from a university in Norway and had said to me, we would love you to come and talk. Now, I thought, this lady now is just saying this is not for real. I didn't believe her.
Checking over your shoulder.
Absolutely. I thought it was a joke. I didn't know. Nobody comes and asks you these things. And if they do, you know, it's the heat of the moment. And I hadn't really heard of TED Talks at the time. I knew the TED Talks, the big ones, but not the TEDx, which was only kicking off at the time. And TED Talks are not as big as they are now. But she said, no, we're going to make this happen. We want you to come to our TEDx event. It's in November. It's in Bergen in Norway, and we'll make this happen. And 2 weeks later, my flight tickets arrived, and the hotel was booked.
Jeez.
So that TED Talk was... how to protect your online personas. Because even back then in 2012, we were identifying that privacy and people's different personas were going to be an issue going forward.
Yeah.
We were sharing quite a lot online, but we weren't differentiating between the private, the business and the company.
Yeah.
And so I came up with a session that I had been delivering, and then established it a little bit more and expanded it for TED. And I came up with the process that we protect, we promote, and we participate. That's the three things that we ever do online.
Yeah.
We try to protect our values, our brand identity, our privacy. We promote, we tell people what we do, marketing, and we participate. So people ask questions and you can engage.
Was that your sort of alignment to Simon Sinek's Golden Circle?
It was. So the Golden Circle had three components, the what, the why, and how. So everybody knows what we do. That's very easy to protect. So I always aligned those two together. If you ask anybody what you do, they'll answer you instantly.
Mm-hmm.
That's very easy to protect. We know that. But if you ask somebody how they do what they do, they have to pause, they have to think, and then they work it out. I get up on Monday morning, open the shop, answer my emails, yep. right through until Sunday when you close up shop and go to bed. So we know how we do what we do, and that's easy to promote. Most companies stop at that. They tell people what they do and how they do it, and then expect some response. And they're surprised when they don't get it. So I knew there was a gap, and the gap was the why. When you identify why you do what you do, then it's very easy to participate with people online. You will get questions, you will get answers, you will get queries to things you ask mm-hmm. or are questioned on. And it comes from the heart. It's a sense of value, it's ethics,
yeah.
And it is your cause, your belief. I remember having a great discussion with somebody about ethics, and they wanted me to talk about business ethics. And I smiled and quietly said, there's no such thing as business ethics. And I paused, and there was shock. And I went, just ethics. There's just ethics, that's it. You shouldn't have yeah. different for business.
Yeah.
And I think you in your introduction there, you said I have quite the resume, but we all have quite a resume. We build them up over the time. Yourself, you were in Australia, you came home, you bring those experiences, you found life costs. And that makes us the people we are today.
So Simon Sinek's theory on it, the whole thing is people don't buy what we do, they buy why we do it.
That's exactly it. That's exactly it. And it's still true today.
And was there, did you sort of feel that that obviously had an impact on yourself, that whole TEDx talk is where Simon done that talk, he's done it on TEDx himself. Did you find like because it was successful there, I need to bring this into my TEDx talk? Was there any alignment there, or do you just see, I just need to get this message across?
Yeah, I do you know, it was plagiarism. That was the thing. I was thinking, I'm going to stand up and give the same message. I want to give the tip of the hat to the guy who came up with it. And if you look at Simon's website, starting with why, he was very much of the mindset, this is not mine, I don't own this. For me to have impact and change people's lives and the way they think and the way they act, this needs to get out there. So evangelists, take it and run with it. Mm-hmm. So while I was tipping a hat to him, I felt I was part of the message.
And he uses Apple as the example, of course.
He does. Among many, he used the Wright Brothers as an example. Martin Luther King speaking on the mall in Washington. And how do people create followers? So he was talking about leadership, which is another passion of mine. Mm-hmm. And leadership is not a position of authority. A lot of people make that mistake. Leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less. And I think leadership values in Ireland and around the world have diminished because other things have taken over. So a huge passion of mine is reinstating leadership values. Anywhere you have influence, you have leadership.
Hell no. Where do you start with that?
Well, if you look on any organization, it has a structure. But in a company, we look to people to give guidance. But it could be the person sitting beside us who's just joined as an intern. And they have great influence and great knowledge. A football team, you can have somebody who comes on and they're only 2 weeks in the team and they're a fantastic influencer. The whole back line is organized and yet they mightn't touch the ball themselves, but they're able to encourage those around them. Mm-hmm. That, for me, is great leadership. And leadership in business is something I'm passionate about, that you don't just do what you do and how you do it. There has to be a why as well
yeah.
and a reason. So it's something that I brought in. Simon's next video still means something to me.
And you use that across all areas, not just sales, not just marketing, not just branding. You use that across all types of leadership, and you still train that in the programs today?
More so now. It's more something that we've ever focused on because there is a need. I mean, we teach from a business point of view, there has to be a demand for whatever your idea is. If you've no demand, you've no business. It's just
yeah.
a hobby.
Yeah.
You can create demand, but it's the bottom building block of every business. There has to be a demand. Then the economics, then the you do the plan. But from a leadership point of view, we skip over those values sometimes. And it's something that I feel strong about. I spoke about ethics,
yeah.
you know, and I believe that I was successful in sales because I had those ethics.
You believed in what you're selling.
I believed in what I was selling. And I think you have to. Yeah. And you show leadership in that area and you will influence those around you, yeah, and then you build a stronger sales team, which builds a stronger company.
I couldn't agree with that one more. From someone that's transitioned from sort of construction into sort of selling and into some leadership from running some business, but if me or any sales guys that are coming in work with me don't fully believe, 100% believe in what they're selling, it's not good. Forget about it. It's not good. You've got to believe that this is going to make an impact onto someone's life, not even their day-to-day. This is going to make an impact on their life. And do they believe it? I think you've got a great chance. You've worked with a lot of businesses, right, through Entrepreneurs Academy, and you're heavily involved with IB. Have you been involved with IBY since the start?
Since inception,
You've been there since day one.
We were on the pilot, year one. So it coincides, the local enterprise boards transferred into the local enterprise offices 5 years ago. And that year was year one of Ireland's Best Young Entrepreneur. And we were QED training at the time, and now the Entrepreneurs Academy. And our whole ethos is about getting people started up and staying in business.
Yeah.
And that was always at our core. So to be involved with the under 30s, as it was at the time, now the under 35s, was just phenomenal. Three categories, best idea. So you had people coming in with just an idea, and then they went through the boot camp stage and our training, and they were coming out with a viable business idea that was about to launch. Then the next category was best startup, and then best established business, as you yourself have joined.
I know a little bit about it, yeah.
Absolutely, in this year. But so we travelled to the country. We did boot camps around the country in Cork and Waterford and in Tipperary and Portlaoise and Dublin. And they're like your babies, watching these guys grow.
I mean, you must work with, would you have an idea of how many entrepreneurs, how many businesses you might
we've
have worked with?
We've trained about 30,000 people in the Entrepreneurs Academy.
So obviously from that, you've some success stories, I would hope.
You know, I often feel it's unfair to single people
out.
Yeah,
I get that, yeah.
But if I could single one and tie those in, it would probably be Samuel Dinigan.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you why, because... Strong roots, yeah. Mm. He's from North County Dublin, which is my patch.
Okay.
He arrived in founding Strong Roots in 2015, competed in IBYE and got nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't get out of the boot camp stage. And for me, it was a great lesson, because one of my passions, and when everyone asks me for a takeaway, it'll always be resilience, which I'll get to before we finish. But it showed great resilience that he came back the next year and learned from the experience and made it a complete success and got to the national final and then got to EY Entrepreneur of the Year. The business was going really well in Ireland, launched into the UK, and this year has launched into the US and hopes to turn over. And remember, this is a company only founded in 2015, €100 million by the end of 2020, and expanding into that.
Yeah, incredible.
But he is very grounded, and while that sounds like an exorbitant figure, and it absolutely is, he has spoken and worked on his team. I remember we were invited to Lambay Island to run a course with him and his team on leadership, on values, on ethics, and on vision. And for a guy like that to put so much foresight in building the team around him, it doesn't surprise me now that he's had success. I am surprised how much success, or am I? He's a great guy.
Is he one that you would have said, we don't need to put as much lean into him as much as this guy's got it? Do you see it early is what I'm getting at.
I learn as much from the participants they would claim to learn from me.
I'm a huge believer in pattern recognition. You know, you've seen it before, it generally happens again, right? I'm a huge believer in traits in people. If you see these certain traits in people, he'll be good for that role, right? Do you see that in entrepreneurs? Do you see guys coming through and saying he's got the same sort of traits that other guy has, and then he generally goes and does, or is it generally people stay in their own lanes and do their things their own way?
No, it's passion, and that's the trait. And can I say, and this is why I don't like singling people out, because, and Samuel would agree with me on this, Samuel has his course and he's decided to go international. That doesn't make him any more valuable to the one man show or the one woman show who has made a decision not just to get a job but to build a business, and it's just them. And it could be retail, it could be wholesale, it could be selling a product or supplying a service and working from home. There is nothing wrong with that level. It is them making that decision to embrace entrepreneurship and to start and build a business. So we see everybody who wants to be that one person right up to building a large company and scaling it internationally. And we're very passionate about everything from that level right to the top.
You just do great work, I have to say. I've got personal experience with you, so I've been there, been on the boot camps, and I suppose if anyone is listening in and is thinking about getting involved and is under 35, I'd be a huge believer in IBYE, but also the local enterprise, obviously, we have to give them a mention. They do incredible work for feasibility, employment grants, which is no age cap on.
There is no age cap, and we've actually done work. There's a great, fantastic lady called Elizabeth Azeel. She's from the US, and we've worked with her in the past, and she focused on senior entrepreneurship.
Brilliant.
You can set a business up at any time, and it's something we're very passionate about. So your first port of call is your local enterprise office. So localenterprise.ie, you find your local enterprise office where it is local to you. We're in Dublin, there are four local enterprise offices, but there are 31 local enterprise offices nationwide. You give them a call, you look on their website, there are training programs that are run all year round. A full day program is €40, including lunch. You know, it's heavily subsidized. It's everything from start your own business courses to Facebook and social media for business to planning for Brexit, phenomenal, and that would be the first part of call.
They do great work, they really do. I mean, you're touching something there, just bring it back a step. You touched on something where you mentioned resilience. If you were to have one piece of advice to give to any entrepreneur that's starting out or even is established, what would that piece be? Is it resilience?
It comes with resilience is the umbrella heading. Failure is part of the game. And you need to be resilient to accept that. It's how we learn. I've often in my training sessions asked people to remember their younger sister or brother or son or daughter learning to walk. You know, we stand up, we teeter on the edge, we take two steps and we fall down. Technically, we failed. But that's how we learn. We get up, and parents need to look at it. Entrepreneurs need to look at it like parents, that this is how we learn. So failure is part of the game, but failing fast, failing often, failing cheaply is part of the game. That requires resilience. So my one takeaway, to explain resilience, everybody makes bad decisions. It's part of life. Everybody makes bad decisions. What defines us is how we react to those decisions. Unsuccessful people do not change bad decisions, they defend them. So where I talk about resilience is recognizing that this is a failure, recognizing it early, dusting down, standing up and going again. Because version two is always better than version one, version three, version four.
Getting comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yeah, and we often see people try to wait until something is perfect before launching. And that in itself breaks the cycle. You've got to get out there and fail. And you mentioned Apple, like, to tie it back in. Like, the iPhone wasn't perfect when it was launched in January 2007. And if they'd waited until it was perfect, it'd never been launched. But they would have killed the greatest revenue model they ever had, which was version 2, version 3, version 4. We're on version 11 now. And next year there'll be a better version as well. Your business needs to be like that, and it requires resilience.
Absolutely, couldn't agree with you, Martin. Now we're running out of time. I could sit here and talk to you all day. A wealth of knowledge in that brain around sales, marketing, leadership. You've worked with so many entrepreneurs. If people did want to reach out to you and get in contact, where would they find you?
Just Google me. So Google Noel Davidson or Google the Entrepreneurs Academy, and they'll find us. And we have a new offshoot calling the Leadership Academy. So they'll find us under any of those three. And we'd be delighted to help or steer in the right direction. But the local enterprise office is a super resource, and then you graduate then on to Enterprise Ireland and beyond.
No, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming in. We really do. Join us next week, where we're going to be joined by more business experts on more business topics, telling us how they do it. I'm Kieran Brennan. Feel free to contact me on LinkedIn or on Instagram at Kieran Contact. And thanks again to Noel, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you.